was there?
Yeah.
بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه سلم وسلم. بسم الله.
بسم الله. وحكمنا العقلي قضية بلا.
نتابع.
بسم الله. وحكمنا العقلي قضية بلا وقف على عادة أو وضع جلاء أقسام مقتضاه بالحصر تماز وهي الوجوب الاستحالة الجواز.
نعم هذه المقدمة تصعب على المبتدئين خاصة الذين لم يخالطوا علم المنطق لأن هذه لها أمور تتعلق بعلم المنطق، لكن الحمد لله الله تعالى ما كلفنا بهذه المقدمة، فمن استطاع فما فجيد ومن لم يستطع فما بالحمد لله. هي ليست من الأمور التكليفية، هي يعني اصطلاحيات عند الأصوليين والمنطقيين، يعني الحمد لله المهنة لا يتعلق عليها حكم واجب، هي من قدر عليها ومن لم يقدر عليها الحمد لله ما في حرج.
So he said this is the introduction to the book of doctrines. Ibn Ashir begins his text by going into the text of Aqidah, but beforehand he presents
حتى أن تهي إلى الطهارة الحمد لله الأمور سهلة، لا مستفدنا منها ربح وما لم نستفد منها الحمد لله لا يتعلق عليه حكم الحمد لله واجب.
So this introduction that he's going to that he's doing right here is dealing with some rules of logic, because when you get into the section of Aqidah, some of the things are about going to deal with logic about why it's impossible for certain things to be impossible, and why certain things are incumbent. But this section, which is on logic, he said it's for some people that haven't been exposed to this before. It's a little bit hard. So when a person's going through it the first time, don't think because you're not understanding it that's problematic. He said it's not from the things that is an individual obligation. It's just it's something he added here. So he's going to go through it, and if a person finds that they're understanding it, that's good, and if they're not getting it, they shouldn't worry about it, because it's not from the things that are personal obligations. It's just something to aid in understanding the things that he's going to be talking about as far as the Aqidah. And then once we get to the Tahara section, it's going to be back to simple hukums, simple judgments of fiqh. There was one last week. I don't know if there's not enough copies. You can ask Aisha in the office.
نعم وحكم العقل الحكم هو إثبات لأمر لأمر أو نفيه عنه. كنقول زيد قائم هذا أثبتنا له القيام. فإذا قلنا زيد ليس قائما نفينا عنه القيام. يعني إثبات أمر لأمر أو نفيه عنه. حكمنا العقلي ليس الشرعي ولا العادي. بل الحكم العقلي، والنتيجة أننا نتكلم عن الحكم العقلي هو أن الكافر ليست له قيادات تخضع تحت الحكم الشرعي، فلذلك إذا جئنا بأدلة تحكم عليه عقلا يصبح منقادا، فلذلك احتجنا للعقل. أيوة، ولأجل أن المسلم يزداد يقينا. الله تعالى حكى عن إبراهيم عليه السلام أرني كيف تحيي الموتى قال أولم تؤمن قال بلى ولكن ليطمئن قلبي. إذا وجدت الطمأنينة القلبية يزداد القلب إيمانا.
So the first line he says our rational judgment is a proposition that is neither dependent upon empirical reputation nor revealed law. So the types of judgments or statements that a person could make are only three types. The first one is the rational judgment. And he said when we talk about a judgment or a statement, the definition is making a statement that is either you're saying something is or something is not. For example, if we say Zayd is standing, that's a statement. Or we say Zayd is not standing, that's another statement. So we're either establishing something or negating it. In the first sentence, we established that Zayd was standing. And then in the second sentence, we negated that he was standing. So it's either an affirmation of something or a negation of something. And this one, so there, that judgment, either negating something or affirming something, is going to go, each of those three judgments is going to have those two types of judgments. And the first one that he's going to discuss is the rational judgment. And he said the reason that the rational judgment is so important in the chapter of Aqidah is because when we talk about, there's another type of judgment, which is the judgment, a statement made by the Sharia. The Sharia says something is true and something else is false. That's a statement made by the Sharia. But the kafir, the non-believer, does not accept that. He doesn't want revealed law. He wants something logical. So we have to go to logic and make a statement based on logic for him to accept that statement. And he said, and then also for the Muslims, so this is something to aid them in discussing with the kuffar, the people that don't want to accept the statements from the revealed law. And also it's something, knowing these rules of logic will increase a person's iman it will make them more stronger, give them a stronger foundation as far as their faith. He said, for that reason, Ibrahim alayhi salam, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, show me how you raise the dead. He said, don't you believe in that? He said, yes, I believe, but I just want to increase my faith in that.
حكمنا العقل قضية بلا وقف يعني مسألة ليست متوقفة على عادة أو وضع ولا على وضع شرعي جلاء وضحى فيثبتها العقل أو ينفيها أقسام مقتضاه بالحصر تماس أقسام مقتضى حكم العقل ليتطلبوا الحكم العقلي ثلاثة أقسام تميز أي تعرف عن غيرها وهي الوجوب ما أن يكون الأمر واجبا عقليا كوجود الله تعالى وستأتي الأدلة عليه الاستحالة المستحيل كوجود الشريك لله تعالى الجواز الممكنات يجوز في فعله يجوز في حقه فعل الممكنات بأسرها وتركها في العدمات ما أن يكون واجبا أو مستحيلا أو جائزا عقليا وستأتي الأدلة لكل الأقسام الثلاثة في العقيدة إن شاء الله.
So the three types of judgment that a person could make is either a judgment that's based on rationale, on logic, and that's the first one that he's going to be discussing. And then the other one is empirical repetition, which is like something defined by custom, like we say the sun rises in the east. So that's something based on the custom. We know that the sun rises in the east. So I've affirmed something, and I can also say the sun does not rise in the west. And I've negated something. So that's empirical repetition, something that we see happen over and over. Nor revealed law, which is the Sharia. So the Sharia makes a judgment, regardless of what whether our intellect understands it or not. It makes a judgment by saying such is true, and such and such is not true. So the rational judgment is neither dependent upon empirical repetition, and also it's not dependent on revealed law. And its divisions, the divisions of the rational judgment, are clearly distinguished, and they are necessity, impossibility, and conceivability. So things are either necessary, meaning when you make this, analyze something, it's necessary. It doesn't make sense any other way. Or impossible, once that statement is made, it's impossible that statement is impossible to believe. And then conceivability, which is the permissibility, it could happen either way. And he said he's going to discuss each one with proofs. Each one of these are going to be mentioned with proofs.
واجب لا يقبل النفي بحال وما أبى ثبوت عقلا محال. الواجب هو الذي لا يقبل النفي كوجود الله تعالى وما أبى ثبوت والذي لا يصح إثباته هذا هو المحال كوجود الشريك لله تعالى هذا ما يمكن إثباته هذا الأمر. وجائزا ما قبل الأمرين الجائز الذي يقبل الأمرين يعني يقبل النفي ويقبل الإثبات كفعل الممكنات لا يقبل أنها تبقى معدومة ما في، وممكن أيضا أنها توجد إثباتها مثلا وإثباتها وعدمه سواء بالنسبة للعقل. للضروري والنظري كل قسم. الحكم العقلي ينقسم إلى ضروري يعني واضح لا يحتاج إلى تأمل، ومنه ما هو نظري يحتاج إلى نظر وتأمل. وذلك مثاله واضح بالنسبة للعدد، نقول الواحد نصف اثنين، هذا واضح ما فيها أحد يميز ما يقول واحد نصف اثنين واضح. لو قلنا الواحد نصف سدس اثني عشر لابد أن يأخذ أحد قلمه ويفكر.
So the three types of the three divisions are the necessary matter, is that which the intellect absolutely refuses to negate, and then that which the intellect refuses to accept is impossible, and the conceivable is acceptable either way. And then he's going to go into examples of these. And an example of the conceivable is that Allah can do something or he can leave that thing. He can bring something into existence or he can leave it in non-existence. He can do it either way. So the intellect accepts that proposition or that statement that Allah can leave something in non-existence or he could bring it into existence. And then each one of these divisions, the necessary, the impossible, and the conceivable, are then into, each one has two categories, and that's, in the translation? No. So all of these three are categorized as immediately apparent or analytically deduced. So each one, for example, the conceivable, or if we make a statement, it's either immediately apparent or it needs to be deduced. So he said, for example, if we're discussing numbers, if we say 1 + 1 = 2, that's immediately apparent to anybody that has is at an age of discerning; they can understand and respond. Whereas if we were to say that 1 ÷ 1/6 = 12, then a person wouldn't see it immediately; he would have to deduce it. And like this are other hukums, that some are immediately apparent and some need to be deduced.
واجب أن إذن أول واجب على من كلف ممكنا من نظر أن يعرف الله والرسول بالصفات مما عليه نصب الآن. أول واجب على من بلغ سن التكليف ومكنه الله تعالى من النظر بأن أمهله برهة بعد بلوغه يمكنه التعلم بها. أما إذا بلغ أمس ومات اليوم هذا لم يجعله الله تعالى عمرا يطلب فيه العلم. أن يعرف الله تعالى أنه واحد في ذاته وصفاته وأفعاله لا غير ذلك من الصفات التي ستأتي إن شاء الله. والرسول يجب عليه أن يعرف ما يجب في حق الرسول من واجب ومستحيل وجائز. مما عليه نصب الآيات، مما عليه أتى الله تعالى بالآيات القاطعات الدالة على وحدانيته وصدق رسوله وأنهم بلغوا وأتوا.
The first obligation upon the responsible individual is who is able to reflect is to know. So the one who is a responsible individual and is able to reflect, he has both, he's physically mature and mentally mature. He has to know the first thing that's an obligation once he becomes mature is to know Allah and His messengers according to the attributes that His signs indicate. And he says that this obligation is upon him as soon as he becomes comes of age. But he's given a time period to learn those things. So the So if a person were to come of age and did not know his individual obligation, and time enough for him to study those things, if that time passed and then he died without studying them, he committed a sin. Whereas if he came of age, say for example, he came of age yesterday and died today, Allah didn't give him enough time to learn the things that are an obligation upon him, so he's not taken to account for those. So this is if a person does not know these things before he's baligh, before he's a responsible individual, and then time passes where he could have learned them and he did not learn them, then he's in a state of sin until he learns those things. And then the first thing once he becomes of age is to know Allah and His messengers according to the attributes that His signs indicate. The signs that clearly point to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the person must reflect on those signs and reflect on the Quran and reflect on the things that have been transmitted to us and know what's possible for Allah, what's impossible, and what's necessary for Allah, what's impossible for the messengers, what's possible, and what's permissible, conceivable.
ولا بد أن يكون هذا له دليل يثبته له بحيث لا يقول سمعت الناس يقولون ذلك فقلته ولو رجع الناس لرجعت هذا هو الذي حذر منه العلماء وقالوا إنه مقلد والمقلد فيه خلاف عند العلماء هل هو مؤمن أو غير مؤمن ولن ينشيه من التقليد أن يثبت ويكون له من الدليل بحسب أنه لو رجع الناس ما يسلسله ذلك عن وجود الله تعالى وإثبات بعثة الرسل كما قال محمد مولود وفي الدليل كاف الجمل بأن يكون بالتوحيد قلبه اطمئن بحيث لا يقول قد سمعته والناس قائلونه فقلته فمن على الوجود بالخلق استدل مع عجزه عن وجه الاستدلال هل إمكانه أو الحدوث أو معاء أو غير ذلك للإيمان معاء وخير الاستدلال نهج الصحب عجائب الخلق وإخبار النبي
So when a person is reflecting on the attributes of Allah and trying to learn what is necessary and impossible and conceivable for Allah, he has to do this, go through this process to believe in Allah and His messengers. It's not enough for him to just say, I heard the people saying La ilaha illallah and I said it too. And this person is in a state where he heard the people say La ilaha illallah, and he also is in a state that if they were to leave La ilaha illallah, he would leave that with them. So he's just following suit with what the people are doing. He didn't reflect on what exactly that the meaning of Tawheed is. So that person, there's a difference of opinion whether he's a believer or not. So a person has to be able to know the signs of Allah and come to the realization about who really Allah is and what the messenger and who the messengers are, and be at a point that even if the people were to leave faith, he would remain steadfast in faith. Naam. So he said, so a person that's just following what the people are said, he hasn't reflected on Tawheed, he doesn't know what it means, he doesn't know what La ilaha illallah means, he's just repeating what the people are saying, it's taqdeed, it's blind following. And in the kalima, in the shahadatain, it's not permissible to do blind following of the people. You have to understand what it means. I think that's getting into like another وكل تكليف بشرط العقل مع البلوغ بدم أو حمل
نعم
أو بمنيء أو بإنبات الشعر أو بثمان عشرة حول ظهر
نعم كل تكليف بشرط العقل فمن كان فاقد العقل بحيث لا يميز لا تكليف عليه مع البلوغ ذلك لا يحصل التكليف إلا بعد البلوغ والبلوغ يكون بدم وهذا خاص بالمرأة بحيث حاضت في السن يمكن فيها الحيض أو حمل وهذا خاص أيضا بالمرأة إذا حملت فهي معناها أنها بالغة أو بمني وهذا يشترك فيه الأنثى والذكر أو بإنبات الشعر وهذا أيضا يشترك فيه الذكر والأنثى فإذا لم ترى علامة من هذه العلامات الأربع نظر إلى 18 حولا كاملا وبعض المالكية قال بخمسة عشر عاما كذلك الشافعيون.
The definition of responsibility or the takleef is contingent. Takleef is contingent upon intellect coupled with the onset of puberty. So if a person does not have intellect, but yet they have physical maturity, they've reached the age of puberty, they're not in an age of takleef. They have not reached the age of takleef. So there has to be physical maturity along with intellect, and the intellect is where, if they're addressed with a simple statement, they can respond. They can respond appropriately. So the person has to have intellect coupled with the onset of puberty, the physical signs of puberty, and the signs are four. It's either, and the first two are particular to women, it's the menstruation, So if a woman experiences menstruation and that, and she has intellect, now she's at an age of taklif. She's an age of it's the age of responsibility. She has to leave the haram and she has to do the obligatory things. Pregnancy, if a woman never experienced menstruation but she was married and then she got pregnant, then that's a sign of that she's now at an age of responsibility. Or the ejaculation of fluid, which is for both men and women. The ejaculation of an Arabic mani, M-A-N-Y. Or the growing of pubic hair. Hair on the pubic area, and this is coarse hair, not the soft hair, because that could show up even years before the puberty. And if none of these four signs show up, then the person, once they reach 18 lunar years of age, then they're considered the age of taklif. And some of the Maliki scholars said that it was at 15 lunar years of age, and that's also the opinion of the Shafi'is. And it's into the بدخول الثامن عشر صحيح يعني بدخوله في الثامن عشر
أو بثمان عشرة كامل قال ثمانية عشر
كامل
والله
So with the completion of 18 lunar years. Taklif is like the noun. Mukallaf is taklif is the noun, and then the mukallaf is the, what is that in English? No, it's the person. So no. Every responsibility is contingent upon intellect coupled with the onset of puberty. No. يجب لله الوجود والقدم كذا البقاء والغنى المطلق عام.
هذا كتاب من القواعد وما طوت عليه من العقائد. وشرع في القاعدة الأولى من قواعد الإسلام الخمس إشارة إلى حديث جبريل عليه السلام المشهور في البخاري وغيره من كتب الحديث. يجب لله الوجود, يتكلم على من طوت عليه لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. يجب لله الوجود والقدم, يجب لله تعالى الوجود وهو عدم العدم, لا بد أن نعتقد أنه موجود حاشا من العدم. كذا البقاء, كذلك البقاء الذي لا ينتهي. قال تعالى كل من عليها فان ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام, كل شيء هالك إلا وجهه هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن. القدم, تعدنا القدم, كذلك يجب له القدم وهو الأولية التي لا ابتداء لها. حديث البخاري كان الله ولا شيء معه, كان قبل العرش, كان قبل الماء, كان قبل السماوات, كان قبل كل شيء, فهو خالق الشيء. والغنى المطلق, كذلك يجب لنا أن نعتقد أن الله تعالى غني غنى مطلقا, أي عن المحل وعن المخصص, أي الخالق حاشاه من ذلك, وعن المعين الغنى المطلق.
So this is the chapter on the book of Aqaid, and this is also going along the way the hadith of Jibril alayhi salam was that's well known amongst the people. The hadith where Jibril alayhi salam came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and asked them about what is iman, what is Islam, and what is ihsan. So in this text, he's going to first go through iman, and then Islam, and then ihsan. So all the pillars of Islam. So the beginning, the first a foundation of Islam that he's going to discuss is the foundation of iman. So he said, it is necessary for Allah to have existence, wujud, which is, and then he's going to mention the opposite of which is non-existence. So Allah has to have existence. The firstness without end, which is qidam. So he is the first with no beginning. And then lastness without end, he has lastness without end, and because this is opposite to what we know as far as lastness. Our idea of lastness, there has to be an end. But Allah is different from what we can comprehend. So His lastness is without end, baqa. And then absolute independence. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has absolute independence. And what the absolute independence means is that He has no need for, of course, simple things like a person to feed, clothe, and take care of him in those ways. But also, he has no need for a place. He has no need for a time. He has no need for something for something to assist him. So he has absolute independence in all matters. وخلفه لخلفه بلا مثال ووحد خلفه لخلقه بلا مثال ووحدة الذات ووصف والفعال.
نعم. خلفه لخلقه الله تعالى يقول ليس كمثله شيء. وكل الأدلة إن شاء الله ستأتي على ذلك. بلا مثال يعني ليس كمثله شيء، لا يمازله شيء. ووحدة الذات كذلك يجب علينا أن نعتقد أن الله تعالى واحد في ذاته، فذاته لا تشبه الذوات حاشا من ذلك. ووصفنا في الصفات قدرته وإرادته على ما سيأتي من الصفات. والفعال كذلك فعله، فهو الواحد في فعله لا يماثل في ذلك أحد.
And it's also necessary.
ولا يشاركه أيضا الله خلقكم وما تعملون.
And it's also necessary for Allah to have absolute differentiation from His creation, مخالفٌ لخلقه. And this is because in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that there's nothing like unto Allah. There's nothing like Allah. And then also oneness in His essence. And so there has to be oneness. There's no... it's necessary for Allah to have oneness in His essence, in His attributes. His attributes like that He's all-hearing, all-seeing, and so forth. Those attributes, there's oneness. He has oneness about those. And then also in His actions. وَقُدْرَةٌ إِرَادَةٌ عِلْمٌ حَيَاتٌ سمع وكلام بصر ذي واجبات.
نعم. يجب علينا أن نعتقد أن الله تعالى قادر على كل شيء، له القدرة، وهي صفة تحقق لمن قامت به إيجاد كل ممكن وإعدامه. إرادة كذلك يجب علينا أن نعتقد أن الله تعالى له إرادة، وهي تخصيص المقدورات، ككون هذا المخلوق يولد في هذا المحل دون هذا المحل الآخر، ككونه يكون قصيرا والآخر يكون طويلا، ككونه يكون عريضا أو خفيفا، وكون أحمر أو أصفر. هذا هو تخصيص الإرادة. الإرادة هي تخصيص المقدور، والقدرة هي صفة تحقق لمن قامت به إيجاد الممكنات وإعدامها. سمع كلام بصر، سمع كذلك صفة كاشفة لكل الموجودات. بصر، البصر والسمع تعريفهما بحق الله تعالى واحد، كما قال اليحصبي ذي واجباتي، هذه الصفات واجبات لله تعالى.
So it is also necessary for Allah to have power, قدرة. And will, irada. So the will is he has the will to have something created, and then the power is that his ability to create that thing. And then knowledge, that he has knowledge of everything, both general and also knows the specifics of all things. And then hayat, he has life, and then hearing, sight, and speech. And these are all necessary for Allah. يستحيل ضد هذه الصفات لعدم الحدود لحادثات.
نعم. يستحيل ضد هذه الصفات القدرة ضدها العجز، حاشا الله تعالى من ذلك. قدرة إرادة ضدها الإكراه، حاشا من أن يفعل شيء من غير اختياره. سمع ضده الصمع. بصر ضده العمى. مستحيل هذه على الله تعالى عدم الحدود لحادثات، لأن هذه المذكورات كلها تقع للحادثات، والله تعالى مخالف لخلقه ليس كمثله شيء.
So like he said in the beginning of the text that everything is either necessary, impossible, or conceivable. So he went through the necessary things for Allah, and now he's going to discuss the impossible, which are the opposite of these attributes. For example, the opposite of existence, which is non-existence. Emergence from non-existence, which is the opposite of firstness without beginning, and then evanescence, which is the opposite of baqa, lastness without end, poverty or dependence, which is the opposite of absolute independence. كذا الفناء والافتقار
كذا الفناء كذلك الفناء ضد البقاء والافتقار ضد الغنى، كل هذا يستحيل على الله تعالى. عد هذا يحسبه، وأن يماثل هذا ضد المخالفة، فهو تعالى مخالف لخلقه. ونفي الوحدة قلنا واحد في ذاته، هذا عكس ذلك أن يكون له، أن يكون معه شريك، حاشاه من ذلك. عجز هذا ضد القدرة. كراهة ضد الإرادة. وجهل ضد العلم، حاشاه من ذلك. وممات ضد الحياة، فهو حي. وصمم ضد ضد السمع وبكم ضد الكلام عما ضد البصر صمات صمات كونه حاشاه من هذه الصفة كونه يكون مثلا حاشاه يتكلم بأحرف ينطق بحرف دون حرف آخر فكلام الله تعالى ليس بحرف ولا صوت ولا لحن ولا إعراب بل هي صفة قائمة بذات الله تعالى معبر عنها بهذا القرآن الذي نقرأه.
So then the evanescence, which is the opposite of lastness without end, baqa, that's impossible. The poverty or dependence, which is the opposite of independence. Similarity to creation, which is the opposite of absolute differentiation from his creation. Lack of oneness, which is the opposite of oneness in his essence. And then incapacity, which is the opposite of power. Compulsion, which is the opposite of will. Ignorance, which is the opposite of knowledge. Death, the opposite of life. Deafness, dumbness, and blindness, the opposite of hearing, speech, and sight. Yes. Exactly. Allah, all of these are his speech is not like what we understand as speech. His hearing is not like what we understand. His life is not like what we understand as life, because our understanding of life, there has to be a death and there has to be a beginning. So it's totally different from that. All of these characteristics are totally different, and that's why one of the characteristics of Allah is that he has absolute differentiation from his creation. So anything that we conceive, Allah is other than that. I think like to get into that right now probably wouldn't be. We should just go through this and then we'll leave. Actually, you know, the best thing if for questions, if people could like just write them down and then pass them up to me, inshallah. يجوز في حقه فعل الممكنات بأسرها وتركها في المعدمات.
في العدمات هذه الممكنات كلها خلق هذا العالم وتركه معدوما قبل خلقه هذا جائز في حق الله تعالى كبعثة الرسل عليه الصلاة والسلام فهي جائزة في حقه تعالى الممكنات كلها جائز في حق الله تعالى أن يقع قبل وقوعه جائز في حق الله تعالى وبعد أن أوجده شاهدناه فهي واضح بأسرها بجميعها وتركها بالعدمات يجوز في حقه أيضا تركها أن يتركها بالعدمات فلا يجب على الله تعالى من هذه الممكنات شيء جائز في حقها جائز عقليا وشرعيا.
So we went through the necessary and the impossible, and now the conceivable. It is conceivable for him to either actualize any possibilities or to leave them unactualized in non-existence. So Allah can leave things in non-existence, or he can bring them into existence. He has that power. لو حدثت بنفسها وجوده له دليل قاطع حاجة كل محدث للصانع.
نعم وجود ربنا تعالى له دليل قاطع من العقل واضح جدا. وجوده له دليل قاطع واضح جدا حاجة كل أننا إذا نظرنا إلى هذه المصنوعات كلها ما يمكن لأحد يلحقه من خسافة العقل وما لا من ضعفه إلا أن يتبين عنده أن هذه الأشياء لا بد لها من صانع. لو قلنا هذه المدرسة التي نحن فيها أبدا نقول من صنع هذه المدرسة هذه الأشياء من نسج هذا الفراش كل مصنوع لا بد له من صانع. فنحن وجدنا هذا العالم الباهر كله من آدميه وحيوانه ومن سمائه وأرضه وشجره هذا يدلنا على أن هذا العالم له خالق له دليل قاطع حاجة كل موجود للصانع كل محدث معنى مخترع وموجد بعد عدمه هذا لا بد أن نعلم أنه محتاج إلى صانع.
Does everybody have the handouts for this section? Let me see, what do we have up to? No, we'll just stop there.
الله يبارك فيك بسم الله
So the
جيد هذا العمل
If the cosmos had come into existence on its own, then equivalence, no. His existence has an absolute proof. Everything made needs a maker. So the going into the logical proof for the existence of Allah, he's saying that everything made needs a maker. So the fact that we see the creation, that's a proof that there's a creator. Because nobody in their right mind can look at something that's created and say that this came about on its own. He said a person wouldn't have sound mind if they looked at this school and they said this came about by itself. He said, so in the same way we look to the heavens, we look to the stars, the oceans, the trees, everything that's created, if we were to say that this came about by itself, it wouldn't be logical. So the proof that Allah exists is that everything that's created needs a creator.
لو حدثت بنفسها الأكوان لاجتمع التساوي والرجحان وذا محال وحدوث العالمين.
هذا رد على الملحدين، قالوا ممكن أن تكون هذه الأكوان حدثت بنفسها. نعم عادي، نحن متأكدون أننا وجدنا هذه الأكوان قبل وجودها ما كانت موجودة، وجدنا مثلا كثير منها ما كان موجودة. لو كان حدث بنفسه وهو الذي خلق نفسه يكون يستوي التساوي، وهو كونه كان قبل وجوده مستو عدمه ووجوده. وهنا رجح الوجود فمعناها أن اجتمع التساوي كونه كان متساوي العدم والوجود، ورجحانه وهو الوجود بلا مرجح. هذا ما يمكن أن يتصوره عاقل.
So some of the philosophers actually said that they actually argued this, that no, everything that is created doesn't necessarily need a maker. So the Muslims refuted the philosophers. And so they said that if the cosmos came into existence on its own, then equivalence and preponderance would have been necessary, that equivalence and preponderance meet equally. And what that means is that if we say that there is no need for a creator to bring to create things, then everything when it was in a state of non everything that's created when it was in a state of non-existence, it had an equal chance of coming into existence or staying in non-existence, because there was no creator to make that choice. So there was an equal chance of it coming into existence or staying in non-existence. But the fact that we see that it has come into existence, those scales need to have been tipped. So it's like if you have scales, there's an equal, it's a 50-50 chance. It could have come into existence or it could have not. But the fact that those scales were tipped, that's a proof that there was something that that those scales had to, there was a tipper to those scales. But if we say that if there is no creator, nobody to tip those scales, then we have to join between the fact that there was a 50-50 chance of it coming into existence and that there was more, there was like a 60-40 chance, because now that we see actually in existence. So those things, to have those at the same time is impossible. You can't say that this thing has a 50-50 chance and a 60-40 chance at this of coming into existence.
ولا محال هذا الذي كنا نقول محال تاب
وذا محال وحدوث العالمين من حدث الأعراض مع تلازمه.
نعم هذا محال، هذا الذي كنا نقول مستحيل. وحدوث العالمين، حدوث العالم له علامة أيضا تدل عليه، وهي أنه تلازمه أعراض حادثة. فهذا الإنسان الذي هو أول العالم وهو الذي يملك غيره من العالم، هو تتجدد عليه أعراض حادثة، غضب وسرور وفرح ومرض وصحة، تحدث له ملازمة له، افتراق واجتماع، يعني كان يكون مجتمع مع هذا الشخص ويفترق معه ويجتمع معه الآن، قعود قيام، هذه الأعراض تلازمه وهي حادثة لا شك. وكل ما لازم حادثا فهو حادث، هو ما ينفك عن هذه الأشياء، هو ما يمكن أن ينفك عن هذه الأشياء. فلما كان ما ينفك عنها فهذا دل على أنه هو هذه الأشياء ملازمة له من طبيعته، فلما حدثت صار هو حادث، مع أنه واضح حدوثه لأنه موجود أمس، هذا واضح، لا يمكن أحد يكذبه.
So then the philosophers went on to say, well, who's to say that this is actually created? If we were to say that the fact that we see this in creation is a proof that there's a creator, and the reason for that is because we can't join between equivalence and preponderance. Then the philosophers went on to say, well, who's to say that this is actually created? And then the Muslims refuted that by saying, So then in the line, that is clearly inconceivable. So that previous statement, which if the cosmos came into existence on its own, then equivalence and preponderance meet equally, that is clearly inconceivable. That's impossible for the intellect to accept. As for the createdness of the world, it is clear, it is clearly discernible from the occurrence of accidents that are created and the inseparability of those created accidents from the entities through which they exist. So you have things which are in Arabic, A'rab, so that would be like A, apostrophe R-A-D, A'rab, and then the alam. حدث الأعراض اللي هو
الأعراض الملازمة لهذا العالم كله.
العالم نعم.
And so then العالم the المخلوقات عالم اسمه ما سوى الله.
The عالم which is a apostrophe a l a m. So you have two things which are the أعراض or the أعراض and the عالم. The occurrence, the accidents, those are the أعراض. Those are like characteristics. So if we say something is blue, or something is moving, or something that you wouldn't be able to see movement without something moving. Like if we look at a glass and we say it's moving, or we see a car, it's moving. So that the fact that it's moving, that idea or that concept is a created thing. That movement, it's created. And the car is the alam, or is the created accidents, is the entity. The car would be the entity, and the movement of the car would be the accident through which and so the entity, the car is the entity through which that accident exists, can only exist, because you cannot understand, for example, the color blue, that's an accident. If we see a shirt that's blue, the shirt is the entity, and the blue is the accident. But you can't realize blue without something being blue. Nobody can say that they've ever seen blue by itself. So the fact that we see those things, the inseparability of the accidents from the entities, because the ahdath, we're seeing those things come in and out of creation. We're seeing movements. A car moves, and so that movement came into creation, and then it stopped, and then it went back into non-existence. So we're seeing things come in and out of creation, which is a proof for that those are created, that those accidents are created. And so if the accidents are created, then the entities through which they exist are also created. Accident. But you understand arḍ, right? Like characteristics? So is that clear? The clarification was, is it accident or incident? I think accident. What's the definition exactly in English? I mean, it's not, I don't... You understand the idea, though, right? It's the characteristic. So that's what the word that he used here in the translation, that's what he's trying to clarify. That idea of the characteristic, movement, blue, hot, cold, all those characteristics, a'rad. So if you just go to the Arabic, that will save from the translation. But is the idea of those two about the equivalence and the preponderance meeting, and then the createdness of the world, are either of those... are both of those clear? Are there any clarifications that need to be made? So, like, if you have a piece of paper, it's white. So the whiteness is from the أعراض.
نشوف فالعين وما بين العرض ضد العين هو الأشياء ذات وعرض. فالعين ما بنفسه يقوم وما سواه العرض المقوم. العين ما هو قائم بذاته كالشجرة وكالإنسان. والعرض ما يطرأ ما يتجدد على هذه الذات وما يمشي عنها. فهذه الشجرة لما تأتيها الرياح فتمشي غصونها إلى يمين وإلى شمال، هذا عرض تجدد عليها. فهذا الإنسان هو ذاته، هي الذات، هي العين. والذي يتجدد عليها كالفرح وكالغضب وكالحمى وكالصحة وكالحمرة وكالصفرة يزول ويمشي، هذا هو العرض.
So for example, like a tree, the tree is the entity, and the movement of the tree when the wind hits it, that's the ard, A-R-D, the accident or the characteristic, whatever you want to call it. But that accident or that ard cannot exist except through the tree. It cannot exist on its own. So the entity is something that exists on its own, in and of itself. And the accident or the arḍ has to exist through that entity. Or a human being. A human being goes through different states, emotional states, happy, sad, some physical states, cold, hot, sick, healthy. So all those states, they come and go. Those are the accidents or the arad. And the entity through which they exist is the human itself, or the piece of paper, the white. That whiteness is an accident. The actual paper itself, that's the entity. If we burn this paper, it removes that accident of whiteness. So we've now just seen that whiteness go out, go from existence to non-existence. Ayn.
Ayn هي ذات.
Ayn, ذات, or علم.
عرب.
Apostrophe A, I, N. What's that? Yeah, if there's any questions, or what's that? Individual. Like we're about to pray, Isha. No. No, in the house.